main world I'm creating. Domesticated dogs are most closely related to the painted wolf, Lycaon pictus, rather than the grey wolf, Canis lupus. So even though they're going to fill a similar niche to dogs in our world, they'd still be noticeably different. But like dogs in our world, once humans domesticated them, they were introduced to new habitats, and later accompanied humans on different tasks. And so different breeds emerged. And I want to figure out what those would be like. Most of them will have a few traits in common, just because they're domesticated. There's been an experiment running in Russia since, like, the 60s, where foxes are selectively bred based only on how positively they react to human interaction, to better understand what traits are associated with domestication. Changes started to happen pretty quickly, within a few generations. The animals that are more okay with humans have less adrenaline and more serotonin, so tamer animals are less stressed, less alert, and so less likely to respond negatively to human interaction, while animals in the wild need more adrenaline because their survival is more at risk. The foxes developed more mottled and piebald colours, presumably because they weren't so reliant on natural camouflage in order to survive. Floppier ears and curlier tails, and neoteny, which is basically that they look more like babies. These features can be further selected for by humans finding them cute, but they seem to be intrinsically tied to the hormonal changes of tameness. These dogs have traits of neoteny, like a shorter snout and larger eyes. They often have curly tails and floppy ears. They have more colour variety than their wild cousins, often with large patches of colour, since young painted wolves have big patches of black and white, and that ties into the neoteny thing. But they tend to still have patches of their distinctive pattern, because that's still important for identifying each other. They're still really social animals, after all, they're just incorporating humans into that society. They become more able to follow human eyelines, and develop additional muscles near their eyes that humans find expressive. And as humans spread through the world, their dogs come with them. Nomadic people in the more arid desert regions keep dogs for help with hunting and herding. To deal with heat, they have thin legs and thin fur. And to run effectively on sand, they've got wide paws. These dogs get used to hunting and living in smaller groups, and so begin to lose their distinctive patterns. Plus, flat colours help them blend in, and lighter fur helps reflect heat and light away from the body. Over time, most of these desert dogs fit on a spectrum between two variants. There's a plain golden dog with upright ears, used for hunting, and a patchy-eared dog, used for herding. These dogs tend to have floppy ears and curly tails, since these are associated with less adrenaline, and you don't want your herding dogs to get too overexcited. North of this sea, there's a more Mediterranean climate. Elish is somewhere around here. Painted wolves actually do okay in their original form, and there's a pretty large feral population. Humans have a few different uses for dogs here. Hunting, herding, catching vermin, protection, general companionship. But each dog might fill multiple of these roles, so they aren't really differentiated. In Elish, where multiple eyes are associated with divinity, dogs with markings resembling eyes are often gifted to temples, and so there's a population of dogs bred in temples where those markings become more common. They're sometimes called peacock dogs, and the plain-coloured dogs from the desert are occasionally traded here as a kind of novelty. Going south from their original habitat, the dogs adapt to colder climates. The further south, the thicker their coats get, they store more fat, and their ears get smaller, to help conserve heat. Since these dogs aren't descended from grey wolves, their cold climate variants aren't going to look that wolf-like. For example, grey wolves have their lightest fur by their eyes, nose and mouth, and dogs like huskies follow that pattern. But on a painted wolf, this area is black, basically the inverse pattern. So on this world's dogs, this area can be darker than, or the same colour, as the rest of the head, but never lighter. Their patterns end up less like grey wolves and more like snow leopards, with mottled white, brown and grey patterns. So, these types of dog provide the basis for all dogs in this world. At this point in this world's history, humans mostly live alongside dogs rather than owning them. That means they don't usually have enough control over dogs' reproduction to do much artificial selection. The first evidence of selective breeding in our world is from 9,000 years ago in Siberia, where hunting dogs and sled dogs seem to diverge. And since then, a lot of dogs have been bred to assist humans in increasingly specific tasks, from catching animals in tunnels to rescuing people on mountains. But it's taken a long time, and a lot of control, for us to get to the point where there are hundreds of dog breeds, defined by increasingly specific appearances.